So over a year ago, I did a little video called the You're Not Stupid Guide on installing Amiga games onto a hard drive. To this day, it's still one of my most viewed videos. It's just this channel's been all downhill since then. But in the video itself, I show you how to install games onto a hard drive, but I'm assuming that you've all already, you know, got your hard drive working. I pretty much just said, you know, go figure it out. It's not that hard to do, and that is the truth. It's not that hard to do. Nevertheless, you know, it's time to actually show off. Actually physically installing a real hard drive, and I'm even going to go on the emulator, too, a little later on, and show you how to do it on the emulator, which is also extraordinarily simple. It's an extraordinarily simple thing to do on an emulator, and there is no excuse anymore for anybody out there to ever complain about an Amiga game with just terrible loading times. You know, it just takes too long to load. It's unbearable. Play it on DOS, which has a hard drive, because it's just terrible on the Amiga, which has floppy drive and a hard drive. You can play it on the floppy drive, or you can play it on a hard drive in most cases. That would be one up for the Amiga, not DOS. So let's stop this DOS love, because things are just simpler in DOS. That is so not the case. Nothing is simpler in DOS. You know, the fact that the Amiga, you could just put in a floppy, could have, you know, 3, 4, sometimes 12 floppies for a game. You know, the fact that that is possible, that's a good thing. Don't never ever again criticize the Amiga, because there is no game on the Amiga that has 4 discs and over that did not have an install program. So if that's the case, and you hate the load times for a game, do what everybody else did for DOS, and you get a hard drive. And these days, if you have the real machine, you know, if you either have it because, you know, you inherited it through years of whatever, you had it back as a kid and you still have it, or you went out and you bought one, and these things, they can go for over $100 still, get a hard drive. And this is a GVP model, a GVP, Great Valley Products. That was a very popular peripheral company. They made lots of accelerator cards, hard drive cards, memory cards for the Amiga. They are all over the advertisements in the American magazine Amiga World, and these suckers could cost just as much as the machine did, if not more, back in the day. You want 8 megabytes of RAM, you want a hard drive, you know, a 50 megabyte hard drive, you're paying just as much as the actual Amiga. So back in the day, I understand not everybody got the hard drive, including my dad. My dad, we never had a hard drive for the Amiga, but there were plenty of people, especially in America, that had hard drives for the Amiga back in the day. That was a power user thing. Lots of people used them. Lots of games supported them, especially the American games. Now, with the majority of people who are using emulators, there really is simply no excuse, ever, to be inserting and ejecting floppy disks over and over again, or to be even boosting the floppy drive emulation. There's no point to it when you can have it on the actual hard drive. There's a lot of people are going to point to WHDLoad on the Amiga, which that will install just about any game, even the games that normally could not be installed onto a hard drive. As long as they write a script for it or something, you could install that onto your hard drive. But the thing about that program is it has very heavy, heavy specs that is required. You cannot use it on a real Amiga 500, and this is, in terms of the actual Amiga, well, this is the biggest selling model, so this is the most common thing you're going to see. You need an Amiga 3000 at least to get a program that, in essence, gives you an emulation kind of feel. Now, it's actually working with the hardware, so it's not a direct sin, but the menus that come up, you know, the loading of games and the options in that system. It's just, and the fact that it's a certain game, like a Lemmings game, which has a bootloader, so you can't install it onto the hard drive. And it's only got a couple discs anyway. You know, but a game like that, which never would have worked on the hard drive, suddenly you can have it work on the hard drive. It's just, to me, it's fake, and it's complicated as all hell. good luck ever figuring out how to get that to work. Because I've looked at it before. I have no intention of using it, but I've actually sat down several times in my emulation days, and I sat there and I'm like, how am I going to get this thing to work? And I just pour over the instructions, and I love my instructions, and I pour over these lists, you know, do this, do that, do that, do that, and I'm like, no, I can't do it. This is stupid. It's too complicated. It's bullshit. No, most people are never gonna bother with this bullshit. But you can do this. This is not complicated. The hard drive is not complicated, which is why I'm gonna show it on the actual emulator to show you how easy it is. And there's just no excuse not to do it if you have an emulator. If you have the real machine, there's no excuse not to get a real hard drive anymore. Because this sucker, yeah, it still costs what the Amiga costs, but that ain't that much anymore. Okay, this cost me $100, I believe. And it came with, I don't know, like a 500 megabyte or something hard drive. But it also had 8 megabytes of RAM. So I'm telling you, it's a very good added peripheral. It's a very good peripheral to have. And if you're going to spend money on the actual Amiga, if you're going to love the Amiga and spend all this time with it, you know, why not? Why not spend a little extra money? I understand if you can't afford it, that's fine. Deal with the floppies, that's okay. That's okay. But if you can't afford it, and I think a lot of people can't afford it, if this is a pleasure that you have, then by all means, splooge a little, go on to eBay and pick up a GVP hard drive, or the many variants of hard drives that were actually available for the real machines themselves. It's going to be a lot easier for the desktop-based Amigas, but the option is there for all of them to have hard drives and to have expansions, accelerators built into these things too sometimes. So you could have an Amiga 500 that is way faster than Amiga 1200. You know, it won't have the AGA capabilities, but who cares, honestly? You know, AGA, handful of games that didn't come out for DOS anyway, you know, that are worth playing on the AGA platform. So you can have your Amiga 500 equal in every single sense the Amiga 1200 and beyond if you want. You know, it's all there if you want that. I don't particularly need that or anything, but it's there if you want it. It's there to tinker with. I did want a hard drive because I was just tired of all the disks. I've already amassed this, you know, couple boxes full of floppy disks for the Amiga. I had to get rid of some of them. I had to get some of these games onto the hard drive, which is why I bought it. And this is the best investment I ever made for the Amiga, is this drive. The problem is, well, you know, not so long ago, about a month ago, the hard drive that was inside of it died on me. And one day I booted up the Amiga and it was going, and it was making noises, it wouldn't boot up, it was just dead. Now, I was able to coerce the old hard drive into working again by taking it apart and moving it around and tilting it certain ways, and I managed to get everything off the hard drive, transfer it over to my Windows 98 machine, and I'm going to transfer it back eventually. But in the meantime, I thought this was the perfect excuse to show everybody how to actually install an Amiga hard drive and take a good look at this very expensive for the time, this very awesome hardware peripheral, the GVP Great Valley Productions Incorporated Impact Series 2 Amiga 500 Plus Hard Disk / Memory Expander. It's a good chance to take this apart, look at it. I've already taken it apart. There's no hard drive in it right now, but I'm going to show it all to you. I'm going to show you how to take it apart. I'm going to show you how to put a hard drive into it. And we're going to actually, you know, show you how to get workbench and everything, how to get this sucker booted up. So I hope you have fun. This is the You're Not Stupid Guide. 2 years, everybody. 2 years since I did the first You're Not Stupid Guide. Hope you all enjoy this one. So when you get a hard drive, especially for the Amiga 500, it's probably going to come looking like something like this, because everything attached to the Amiga 500's built-in expansion bay through the side of the machine right here. This is what that looks like. It's a very simple thing, not much to it. On the outside, lots of screws. I don't have them all anymore. I don't think it shipped with them all, but we have a game switch and a auto boot switch, and all that does is
tells, the hard drive is going to run no matter what. It's going to be on, but the instructions, it's not communicating. It won't be communicating with the computer if it's switched to game switch. So all that will do is it'll save you memory because the drivers and such will not be loaded. And you'll get that extra memory for the games if you don't need the hard drive. Auto boot will allow it to auto boot on Workbench 1.3 and higher. 1.2, I do not believe it will auto boot, but you can. It'll still work. You just gotta still have the Workbench disk itself in order to boot the system. In order to take this off, we flip it around. Now, of course, when you get this thing, you know, plug it in directly and see if the hard drive still works. Mine worked for several years, fine, just fine. So that might be all that you need. But if you need to take it apart, you know, take off some screws. I believe it is held in here, here, and here. This is what holds this portion together. These other screws are for the hard drive, I believe, although I do not know what those two are for. But yeah, we'll take this apart. These are just screws I found around. I have the screws somewhere for it. These are temporary screws just to so I can take it apart so you guys can see it, because I already had it apart, but you know, I feel it needs to be taken apart again. So I think that's all I need for now. It's these three, and it should come off now. Yeah, it'll come off here. It might be still connected to some of these jumpers because the switch itself is connected to this jumper here. Without this switch, nothing will happen to this hard drive. It will not work at all. It has to be plugged in. This switch is a necessity. It has to be plugged in. There's also a fan there. This is a custom fan I got from another computer and put it in. The fan that it came with was terribly loud. It was way louder than the hard drive. It was an annoying piece of crap. I think it was a little bigger than this. But the fan output, it was not outputting that much air, and it was loud as hell. So like I've done on previous things, I just, you know, I got it out and I put a new one in. There's actually nowhere really to mount it, which sucks because this would be so much easier to clean if I didn't have to worry about that fan. But I did have to glue it in. I used some kind of plastic glue. And that is how it is being held in. But I definitely recommend if you get one of these, and change that fan, because that original fan was so terrible. And that's this. This will come out if you need it to come out. Now you can press the sides of it in, and it will come out through the top. And there's your game switch. So if you're fooling around with it and you don't want the cover on, you can just connect the switch there. That was a pretty good shot there. So this is the original hard drive that was in mine. I guess it's not the original because it's from Apple, and it's from 1994, I believe. Firmware 1994, manufactured by Quantum for Apple, but Apple is Apple in big letters there. This hard drive failed on me recently, so we need to replace it. So if you wanted to replace it for whatever reason, because it's not big enough, or it's failing, or you just want to be safe, this is how you do it. So to take this hard drive off, we come back here, and it is being held together. Again, like these two screws here, I am not sure what they are for, because there's no placement for them. It kind of looks like right here may have been, at one point, you know, a spot to connect extra screws for, but obviously, it was never. Somebody either ripped them off, or this particular model did not come with them. But for the hard drive is held in by these four screws here. Let's take them out. Interesting. These old screws, They just ain't what they used to be. Ain't what they used to be. This one is stuck there. There we go. There we go. Got it out. Fuck me. Jeez. All right. It's being held on this metal plate here. This is the hard drive attached to a SCSI cable and a power cord. This is the hard drive. And I'll even take it apart for you, because I took it apart in order to coerce it into working again, just so I could back up the data. Have some fun with this stuff, guys. It's okay, I promise. It ain't gonna hurt it. It could help it, it ain't gonna hurt it anymore, because if you're fucking with it, then it's already kind of hurt, isn't it? It's okay. So here's the Apple Computer Incorporated, made by Quantum. Hard drive. The innards for you guys. There is the hard disk. It's a, I believe, three heads, I believe. No, four heads. Four heads, I think. I believe that. Yeah, one there, and then that one should have two on the bottom and top, and there should be one on the very bottom there. So that's a four head one. Yeah. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. That's the old hard drive. We've gotten what we want out of it, so it's time for a new hard drive. But just for completion's sake, why don't we take this plate off and show you what else we have here. We have the SCSI cable, of course. Power switch connected in. The fan controls out here. We have several jumpers on the machine itself. These might come out once you mess with it here. They might stay, they might come out. These are the things that hold the hard drive in. We have the RAM slots here. GVP will let you have up to 8 megabytes of RAM. There are 4 slots in it. Perhaps you can see them all here. 1, 2, 3, 4. It'd be the configuration for 8 to use them all would be two apiece, so 2, 4, 6, 8. Or you could have 4 1 megs for 4 megabytes. But here we have 2 4 megabytes for 8. Increasing it anymore, will not help it at all. It will not accept any more than 8 megabytes, unfortunately. Although 8 megabytes on an Amiga 500 is pretty damn fast, I have to say. Just the RAM itself really does boost it up to the level of other better machines on the Amiga line. It feels, just like an Amiga 3000 would. SIM RAM, I believe it is, standard RAM back in the day. Probably cost a fortune to have these 2 4 megabytes back then. But, I have a bunch of these still, but they're probably 32 bits. I believe these are probably 16 bits. I got a processor of some sort, maybe. It'll come out. It's made by AMD. Nice. 1986 AMD. Exactly. If it's a processor or just a ROM. Version 3.07 or something. Great Valley Productions Incorporated, A500 HD8. I've heard of the HD8s before, but this one does not actually say HD8 on the actual cover, but inside it does. It says HD8 Series 11 Revision 2. What the hell is this for? I don't know. It's got to be an extra expansion for something, maybe. I don't. There is a reason that this is here. I think what it might have been for is for emulation of PCs back then. That's sort of what I'm thinking, looking back. On the back, there is room here. I believe that here. Yeah, this is room here for an expansion. I guess another floppy drive. You could put a floppy drive there, I suppose, or something. I don't know. This is for power, I believe. Although, I don't know, I don't need power. Personally, this thing seems to do just fine hooked up to my Amiga 500. I've never had to hook it up to anything. So, but there is an external power supply. I believe that's external power supply. And so we're going to get a new hard drive. So problem with these old hard drives. Here we have the original Apple drive here. And this is a SCSI interface, everybody. SCSI interface with power. It looks like an IDE, but the SCSIs were a little longer than the IDEs. Here's the cable for it. It'll go in just fine. Problem with the SCSI drives is the SCSIs have been around and they're still around today, but they don't have the same connectors that they used to. So it's pretty much essentially the same communications that it's always had, and they're still being used today, especially in old servers and such. It's a very reliable medium, SCSI. Very fast and reliable. This is a new SCSI drive here, or newer-ish SCSI drive. It's still old, but this is what the connection it has. Absolutely nothing in common with this original one, and it has no power connection to it. So the power is coming through the cable somewhere. So how do we get this sucker working? Now, at first, when I bought the new hard drive, I knew that the SCSIs, they weren't all the same. And I bought this. I guess I didn't do enough research. But, yeah, this is the wrong kind of adapter. This adapter cost me like $10. And it will fit one way, definitely. We can get it in that way. But, yeah, this itself, it's a negative. Will not connect. So that's a problem. So I bought this $10 thing, and it didn't work, so I had to research some more. And there are several different configurations for SCSI drives. And again, this one I got us this, but there's no cable. So this must have been an interim between the old model and this model here. Eventually another $10 buy, and this is what I got here. This is the correct adapter. This one will go into the new hard drive. This one will connect to the old serial cable, and it's even got the power supply there, and which will connect through the hard drive there. Simple enough. I believe it connects this way. There we go. It's fairly snug. Not super snug, but it's, you know, it's good enough in there. And yeah, we can connect it, power there, connect the cable there, and we're off to the races, pretty much. Still have access to your RAM and your jumper there. Yes, it is. I'm hoping this is just good enough to actually put the sucker back on. I don't know. It's very, very close. This extra clearance, I don't know about, but before we connect them together, well, let's connect them together actually first. Put in the power here. Put in the SCSI cable. And there we go, it is connected now. As you can see, fairly firm. Stay there. Be good. Be a good girl. Put them back in easy enough. Quite there. I think there's something wrong with that one. I don't think I can actually get that one in. It's okay. It's okay because the rest of it's in there just fine. It's very secure. So we got our hard drive in. Let's see if it'll have a snug fit once we fit this on here. Just for a test, see? Let's connect the fan in. These are very loose connections, so you gotta be careful. Very careful with the fans. Got the fan in. Might as well put the switch back in as well. Although you're not going to be sure at first. I believe it's set to auto boot now. I hope it is. Otherwise, I'll have to take it apart again just to do that. So, yeah, we'll See, we can't put this sucker back in. There we go, that's in. I need to hopefully get this so we're not fucking with anything and we can get this on. I want this on. Please come on. So what I ended up doing here was I got rid of the plate here. This adds a little more clearance to it. Tiny bit more thickness there. It just hooked it up right to the screws itself. I guess that'll increase airflow a little bit too. It definitely gets it a little more clearance. I don't know if it'll be enough. But we'll find out when we hook it up whether or not this is hitting the fan. But it seems to put itself back on a lot nicer now. So over here we have the hard drive, all complete and together again, for the most part. Let's hook it up to the Amiga and see what she does. There we have the Amiga's expansion port. Gonna take our hard drive. Going to put it in. Good. Now this is not the greatest, in terms of support for it, but it works. I've had it like that for a long time. I need a bigger desk. I got too many computers, people. Once connected and powered up, you have your switch here. This one's set to game switch right now, which will just give you the classic Amiga Kickstart insert disk image there. Of course, we can come back and we can switch it to auto boot and we can reset the computer. Now you also want a disk. The first time you set it up, if it hasn't been messed with before, you're going to want some kind of a disk. I have this GVP disk, a setup disk, to start up the hard drive. We will reset the machine. We will insert the disk. I will say that this new hard drive I have gives an incredible, a very noticeable increase in boot time, about 10 to 20 extra seconds with this hard drive. I believe it's just because it's doing its diagnostic, because it's a 4 GB hard drive. The other one, I don't know, was only like a 300 MB hard drive. So the bigger it is, the longer it takes, but I'm sure I will get used to it in no time, because once it runs, it seems to be pretty damn good. So we come up to this Amiga screen about the A500 HD8 utility disk. Do we want to access fast prep? But we do, we want to access this fast prep, so we will say yes. Takes us to this screen here. The default setting for this, it says 406 megabytes, but it's 4 gigs, it knows it. It's 3 partitions. You may use this default or choose your own settings. I think I do want three. I had 2 before with the old hard drive, but you do not need it. I've already went through, and we can put all of the megabytes directly into it. We can put all 4,000 into one partition. I've tried it. It works. This is a 4 GB hard drive, a little bit bigger, 4.2 I think it said, but it does give you more, 4,067 MB. So I'm not sure if this thing would allow more than 4 gigs or not. I played it safe with just the 4.2 gig hard drive, but it definitely recognizes a little bit more than the 4, unless is 4,067 exactly 4 gigabytes, I'm not sure. But we can have 3 partitions here, and we can have whatever we want. We can, you know, we can change that to whatever we want. We'll prep and format this hard drive. Warning, this will erase all data on the hard drive. Go ahead. Rigid disk block and partition blocks have now been written. Proceed. Mounting, DH0, I don't know why it says DH0A. It will say DH1A and stuff. I don't know why exactly it goes like that, but it does. But the operating system itself, once you're in it, it reads it as, you know, DH0 like it should. Do you want to copy any disks to this partition? Yes, we do. This is where you want to copy your workbench disk. Okay, so we have a workbench disk here. We're gonna put it in our DF1 drive, our extra disk drive. We'll say yes, proceed. We'll change it to DF1. And we will let it copy this operating system over to the hard drive itself so it may boot and have a workbench environment. So there, we copied our workbench disk over. Do you want to copy any more disks to that partition? Now, we could take this opportunity to copy the Amiga Extras disk, but I'll save that for later to show you an alternative way to copy disks to the hard drive. So we will say no for now, but that would be a good time to copy your extra Amiga Extras disk or whatever. But we'll say no, we will abort. And it will mount the next drive, DH1. Format DH1. It's now mounted and formatted. It'll ask us if we want to copy anything to that partition. We do not. It'll start with the DH2. DH2 is now mounted and formatted. And we do not want to copy anything. Amiga DOS format complete. And that's it. That's all you have to do in this program. There's some other things here, which we do not need to worry about Fast Prep 2.0 Hard Disk Preparation 1992 Great Valley Productions, John J. Kersher. And we will remove our disks from the floppy drive. We shall reset the Amiga, and it should hopefully auto boot with the hard drive. And there it goes, starts up Amiga DOS. This is exactly what you would see if you were to put the floppy disk in. It's obviously a copy of the floppy disk, but it does take it a while to boot. It seems to be going through self-diagnostics that take it a little longer, but once it actually gets on a roll, it's way faster than the last hard drive. So this is what it named our three partitions, DH0A, DH1A, and DH2A.
Hey everyone, so I wanted to overdub in this little special announcement here because I really recommend everybody do this. Now, you saw me install Workbench directly onto the hard drive. You should save that actually. Just format it and let it do its thing. Then put in your Workbench disk, and then you want to come to the hard drive because it'll be there, and you'll want to initialize the hard drive through Workbench. This will go sector by sector. Now, GVP will do a fast format, which doesn't go sector by sector, which means if you just bought this hard drive and it was a dud, you could be screwed later on. So I did it later on just to be safe and everything, and this is just something you really should do. Go sector by sector, and then you can, if it's wrong, it'll say so, and then you can get your money back maybe. So yeah, just an idea. And once you've done that and it's verified every sector is good, then you can, with confidence, go back and do everything I just showed you. And, that is when you want to install Workbench onto the hard disk to have it auto-boot. Because then your disk is 100% good to go for the future.
I will rename these to Workbench to Games. And what should I name the messing around with one? I don't know. I'll just name it Stuff. And I will snapshot it so the icons stay there for now. And what else? Yeah, we can go into Workbench, and we have Workbench. It's all loading up very fast directly from the hard drive. Got our notepad. We can type our stuff in there. Woohoo. I'm surprised at how many options Notepad has. I didn't realize it had so many freaking fonts and stuff. Got your calculator, your simple doodad here. It's functional. You got your say command. Everybody loves the say command.
Hi, Stan. How are you?
In the preferences, you can change the color of Workbench and all that jazz to whatever you might prefer. I'll stick with good old fashioned blue. But you can also, if you had a printer, you can mess with the printer and such. You can edit your pointer into different colors if you wish. We will do that just for now, just for the hell of it. Got a nice fancy purple bluish kind of a pointer there. And that's pretty much it. Workbench doesn't give you all that much, but you have the extra disc. Let's put in the extra disc and copy it over, shall we? If you want to copy other discs, hopefully they have an install program, but not all of them do. This is the extras floppy disk here, which has extra stuff, obviously, including Amiga Explorer, which I put on there. But what we'll do is we'll go to the shell, because it doesn't have an install program, obviously, but we'll type in CD DF0, I believe. Actually, I don't even think we need to do that. We just do copy DF0 all DH0. And it will start copying. We could have done that previously with the GVP utility disk, but this is just another way for you to install disks if you need to. This is the primary method we're going to use in order to install Workbench onto the emulation hard drive that we are going to do a tiny bit later on here. So many printers this thing has. If it didn't have so many printers, my god, how many more things could it have put on there? I'd love to have myself a nice little dot matrix printer again. And there you go, extras has been copied. We'll end the command line. We will go back into Workbench, start up again, and we should have all these other disks and such. It does not do a good job of sorting them, so you will have to sort them yourself a little later on. For now, we'll just, mess with it a little tiny bit. We'll snapshot them in place so they stay there. I don't know how many of these. I believe these are only... We'll just snapshot all this stuff. And that should be good. We'll make this a little smaller, too. And put it more over here, I think. And yeah, and we'll snapshot Workbench again. And there you go. We have a nice Workbench thing with a couple more things. We got our basic demos. Load up the music program. I love the music one. I'll probably play this music at some point and, have a direct hookup to you guys. I used to listen to this just for an hour, like a couple hours. Just love this music here to this thing, and it goes on for quite a long time here, with the lines and everything. Simple little demonstration they have here, but enjoyable nonetheless. All running off of Microsoft Basic there. It's got pictures. I don't think this one's any. Yeah, this one's nothing too special about that. I think it's got some ones that are nicer though, right? Don't you? No, that's not it. What's the one we like? I don't know. There's one that has a million different ones on the screen at the same time, right? No, I don't care about the bobs. I don't know. I don't know what the hell that one does. There's a line program there. That's not the one I wanted, though. We do have another speech program. It's the same as the other one, except it's... Type what you want me to say. It just gives you a bigger overall, play field, and you can mess with it itself here.
Hello there.
Hello there.
How are you?
How are you? I'm good.
I
Demo? What's the demo? That's the one I was looking for. The one that put a whole bunch of them on screen at the same time. This was to show off the Amiga's multitasking capability. But it's preemptive. It's not true multitasking. It's preemptive. Therefore, it seems like it's acceptable right now, but the more you cut away from everything, the faster everything starts to run until eventually, when it's just the one program, everything is nice and super smooth. So it's preemptive, and it's multitasking, and it has great fantastic uses, but it definitely slows down when you multitask. Have Amiga Explorer if we want to connect it to our Windows machine, and we've got the foundation now to have Workbench, and now we can insert game discs and we can install stuff. If you want to see me install games, then check out one of the first videos on the channel where I'm talking about installing Amiga games onto a hard drive. Check that one out if you want to see me actually installing the games onto a hard drive. But for now, we're gonna go into a modern operating system, and we are going to use WinUAE to install a hard drive, because that's how most of you are gonna do it. So let's show you that it's not that hard. It was not hard here, but it's not gonna be hard there either. Hey everyone, so we are now on a Windows 7 PC. We have WinUAE on this PC. Now, in order to get a hard drive, you'll first want to find WinUAE, or I guess you can put it anywhere. Anywhere you wish for it to be, but for the purposes of this, we're going to go to the default location, which should be in Programs x86, and it should be under WinUAE here. WinUAE. Under WinUAE, there's a hard drive. I don't know if that's there by default. If it's not there by default, then simply create a nice hard drive thing. It looks like I have some stuff here already, for this purpose, we're gonna create a new one. And we're just gonna call it YouTube for you guys. And again, we're gonna go in here and we're gonna have a Workbench directory. And we're gonna have another one just called games. You don't have to do this. You can have a hard disk file, which is like an ADF. But the benefit to having it this way is it's dynamic. As it grows, that's how the hard drive is. It's infinite. As long as you have space in there, it's infinite. And the best thing is you don't have to devote 4 gigabytes of space to a hard disk file, and nothing's happening. So that's where it is. Under WinUAE, under the hard drives. Then you will wish to start WinUAE. Now here is WinUAE. I'm going to put it into my default NTSC configuration for now, because Workbench was developed to look correct under NTSC mode. From here we will go to the CD and hard drives. It already has some stuff there, apparently. Let's remove those. We don't need those there. You can add a directory or archive, add a hard file, which, that is, the permanent size. Alright, so what we're going to do is add directory or archive. And the device name is going to be DH0. The volume label is going to be Workbench, read and write, and bootable, correct. And then we're going to find the directory. So let's go to select directory, and it's already got WinUAE there. Go to the hard drives. We went to our YouTube folder, and here it is, games and Workbench. We'll go to Workbench, and that's the folder we wish to have. Just press OK. For the games directory, you're going to do the same thing, add directory. I'm going to call it device DH. One volume label games, and we will again go to select directory, and there's the games folder. We'll select folder, press OK, and that's good. You'll probably want to save that configuration, just so you make sure that the hard drive's always there. Save it under some name, your default workbench hard drive mode, okay? This is when you will need to decide what version of workbench do we want. We're going classic. Screw everybody with their workbench 3.1. It'll probably be a little easier to install because it's going to have the install program on the disk itself, but for this, we don't need it. We don't need it. We're going to just have Workbench 1.3 and Extras 1.3, and we shall start up the emulation. Here is Workbench loading up via WinUAE off the floppy disk. Dear God, what is with the emulation? I swear to God, the emulation is slower, way slower than the real computer is. Workbench has loaded via the floppy, but you will notice we have these special disks here with nothing on them. These are the hard drive disks. We'll snapshot them just to keep them there for now. But if we go to info, you'll see. Well, I don't know what it will say for info because it's dynamic. I guess it made up something there, though, didn't it? But it can be as big as we want it, but there's nothing on it at the moment. There it is. These are the floppy disks, so the Workbench 1.3 floppy disk. How do we get Workbench 1.3 and Extras 1.3? How do we get it onto the hard drive to boot itself? It's simple. It's just what you saw me do earlier on. We will open up a shell. I swear to God, my Amiga 500 is way faster than this thing claims it is. Screw emulation. I hate emulation. Anyway, in order to get it on there, we will simply say copy DF0 all DH0. And it should start to copy everything over to the Workbench drive. And what feels like half a century later, it is done via emulation. Press the up button to get that command again, but we will instead go to DF1 instead of DS0, and this will copy extras over to the hard drive now. All right, that is done. We will end the command line. I swear, everything is so much slower. Okay, so it is now installed onto Workbench. We will open it up quickly, and then you can see everything is on there. We will quickly, just as we did previously, we will attempt to get this stuff the hell away from here. We'll snapshot some stuff. Get the demos over there. Snapshot. Get the basic the hell away from there. Snapshot. Oh, I guess this was up here, wasn't it? Snapshot. Empty folder we'll put over there. Expansion. Alright, that looks fine. We'll snapshot Workbench there. And we will go into WinUAE again. We will eject the floppy disks so you guys know that they are no longer there. I don't know why it's there, but there we go. There, it's not there anymore. So now we will reset the Amiga. And hopefully it will have our new hard drives there all ready to go for us. It is launching. And it's really as simple as all that, guys. There it is. There is a Workbench with everything we just installed. We have our basic demos. We can again go to the music and listen to the music play. Music is the same way. It doesn't sound the same at all. I swear to God, it's so much better, the real thing. But for everybody else that, it's not practical for you guys to have the real system, well, you have the emulation there, and I used to do it too, so I guess it's okay. It's all there. It's all onto the hard drive. There's no floppy disk here. It's on the hard drive. You have the games directory, so if you put in a game which has an install program, you can always install it in your games folder. If you want more info on that, again, check out my video that I did previously, my first You're Not Stupid guide, where I show off how to install games onto your hard drive. But here it is, via WinUAE. It's all there for you guys. It's as simple as that. Very, very simple to add your own hard drive. I hope you enjoyed the video. I hope you will subscribe. I hope you will check out some other videos. And I hope I will see you all again later. I'll see you later. Bye.